it's tough to get old. I appreciate the good words. We have a strong family. I have a grandson preaching in Pastor Robles, Brent's son, Bruce, building a great church. Have another one in Marysville. He's got a blossoming, booming church. And then I have another grandson in Delaware that's probably going to pastor. And a big, handsome, 6'3", 17-year-old kid that's in Dayton, Tennessee, that I'm sure he's going to pastor. Talk about Val. God has got his heart. And that all comes. Brent and I both surrendered to preach before about 5,000 people. He was 16. And I had been saved not too long ago, just a few months after I was saved. I don't know how I knew. I guess the pastor from Monta Vista Chapel in Turlock, California, we were running about 1,400 people. I was just an old farm boy, and I started telling people about Christ. And they just couldn't get over how people could really be saved and want to be saved. So they invited me on as a staff member, and after several years, I knew I was over my head, and so I went on to college and got my degree and have continued school over all these years. But the story's always the same. I'm going to preach. There's something very supernatural about God. And the things that men do and the things that men can do are really based upon how much they believe in the power of God. And there are people out here that you probably have a very low sense of your own self-worth. You may not think you're worth a whole lot or that you can do a whole lot. Some of the greatest feats that God ever did were men over their 70s, some of you even their 80s. For example, the man that built Sears and Roebuck's was a Christian. The man that built Sears and Roebuck's was a Christian. The man that built Colonel Sanders' chicken, Christian, 72 years of age when he started the company. And now they're running about 1,500 stores. The man that owned Chick-fil-A is 86 years of age. He just passed away. About 40,000 employees and over 800 or 900 stores. Used to teach in Roanoke, Virginia at a Southern Baptist church. 13-year-old boys every Sunday. Because he had a conviction that he couldn't teach 13-year-old boys and be a hypocrite, he shut all these restaurants down on Sunday and would not sell anything on Sunday so his employees could go to church. And God blessed him, and he sold more chicken than he is today in 6 days, and all the rest of them are selling at 7. Because God is the God who we believe he is. Rockefeller, the man that built Days Inn, was a 41-year-old drywall contractor. Art DeMoss built one of the biggest insurance companies in the world. He was a 25-year-old alcoholic. Made a statement to his partner. He said, "I believe I'm going to offer a policy where we give smokers a discount." And his partner said, "You're crazy." And 1,500 employees later, and a billionaire, he built one of the largest insurance companies in the world. A guy named R.G. Letourneau built all they used to do all the road work and all these heavy lift scrapers and so forth. He used to give 90% of all he made because God had blessed him so mightily. We attend Desert Gateway Baptist Church in Gilbert, Arizona. And Desert Gateway Baptist Church just runs about 400. We support 115 missionaries. And some lady just casually walked into the church. We've been there 8 years. And just before we came, she walked into the church and just wrote a check for $7.5 million and dropped it in the plate. But see, God knew what they were going to do. He knew they were going to support missionaries. He knew what they were going to do. God has all the money in the world. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. He doesn't need your money. He needs your heart. And that's what we're going to talk about this morning. Preaching is much like, I was raised on a vineyard. I was raised on a farm. I was an agricultural manager for many years of my life. Ran several large agricultural plants. During the high season, I'd have 100 men work for me. And I got saved in 1971 at a Bible conference reading a tract. Now, if you're not saved this morning, if you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, and you're thinking that you're unworthy and God couldn't save me, that's a lie from hell, and you are unworthy. We all are. None of us, the Bible says, there's none of us good, no, not one. But in the righteousness of Christ, we are something to behold in the sight of Almighty God. In the book of Revelation in chapter 19, it says that we are to write the things which thou hast seen, and the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter. So preaching is basically preaching what is, preaching about what is to come, and preaching about what will be, and preaching about the things that we've seen and heard. I want you to go to Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4, and we're going to look at verses 2. If you have a sense of unworthiness, I want to dispel that probably that sense of unworthiness can be a form of very unsophisticated pride, because we're all sinners at best. And God can save anybody. I don't care who you are or how far down you've come, and He's come to seek and to save that which is lost. It says, let us therefore fear, in verse 1, a promise that was left of us entering into the rest, that any of you should come short of it. Now I want you to look at verses 2. It says, for unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. There was a lot of times it's not up to us to save. We always had a saying at Monte Vista Chapel that sharing Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit, and we leave the results up to the Lord. I can't save anybody. You can't save anybody. The Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, and it's a divider of the thoughts and intents of the heart. It's the Word of God that saves. It's the Holy Spirit that draws. And when you think that, to give you a prime example, we were coming up here. It's a three-hour flight. I was sitting by a guy. His name is Juan Carrion, 29 years of age. He's stationed at Fort Lewis. And I always have a great fear that I'm either going to be in front or back of some young couple with a baby or two babies, like my great-granddaughter out there. And somehow they get an urge to cry for 3 hours at a high level. And in this case, we were sitting in the front row. And this young man, he came in and he asked if he would sit between my wife and I. I said, sure. And he's married, been 5 years, been divorced, got a five-year-old daughter. Nice-looking man. And I was sitting there kind of dozing, and he was dozing, and I was saying, Lord, if you want me to talk to this guy, let's open the door. And I began to preach Christ to him. I couldn't shut him up. I'd start to quit, and he'd keep after me. He stayed. I preached to that guy for an hour and 30 minutes, and he could not get enough of the Word of God and the questions, and he was going to go home. And just about the time we were talking, to some lady had a heart attack or a stroke or something. There was a turmoil up in front just before we started to land. But he assured me that he would go home and get off on his hands and knees, and he would bring Christ into his life, hungry for the Word of God. and all over this great country. We have to get a vision of what God wants to do with our life. And what I'm going to preach about in just a minute, and I'm laying foundation, is God is looking for vessels. They don't have to be good-looking vessels. They don't have to be healthy vessels. They don't have to be men vessels. They can be kids. They can be seniors. They can be middle age. God is looking for vessels. God is not going to pour milk in a dirty vessel. All you have to be a vessel, you have to be clean and you have to be available. God is looking for vessels. The Apostle Paul was walking down the Damascus Road, fervent in his faith, a Hebrew of the Hebrews, fervent in his faith, killing Christians. Now you think about this, killing Christians, murdering Christians because they would not obey the Mosaic law. And God from heaven struck him down, and here was a man killing people, committing murder, and God struck him down and filled him with the Holy Spirit, blinded him, and he became the great Apostle Paul. And he said to those that were condemning him, he said, "Leave him alone. He is a chosen vessel, chosen by God to carry out the purpose that we've called him to do." Every one of you in here, I don't care how large or small or how young or old, when God gave you breath in the very beginning, God called you with a purpose in this life. If you're not saved, you need to be saved. If you're not saved, you should be saved. If you're not saved, you're here because God wants you to be saved. Until you get saved, God will not have anything to do with you, though he wants to save you. You can be saved if you're old. You can be saved with your young. My wife and I go out to dinner every Thursday night with a man that's 99 years of age. I personally led the man to Christ. We go out. He's driving at 99 years of age. He plays bridge and he plays pinochle. And I try to find out the days he's driving so I can get off the road. But this old man is reverent, and he fell in love with my wife. We call him every day, and he's was saved at 99 years of age. It's pretty amazing. So at any rate, God is looking for vessels. Now I'm going to tell you a story in just a minute. We're going to go to 2 Kings. You can turn. We're going to 2 Kings chapter 1, 2 Kings chapter 4, and we're going to deal with a widow woman that had lost her husband. Before we do that, I'm going to preempt the story by some other things, some other stories. I'll read 2 Kings chapter 4, and we'll read verse 1, and then I'm going to tell you some other stories, and then we'll get to the sermon, and I won't be lengthy, but I think what I'm going to tell you is rather profound, and God would have you hear it this morning. In chapter 4, verse 1, it says, "Now there cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets unto Elisha." If you remember the story, Elisha was the prophet that demanded a double portion from the prophet Elijah. Elijah was the prophet that was taken up into heaven and in a flaming chariot. And Elijah said, asked God for a double portion. And God, in fact, gave Elisha a double portion. And her husband had apparently been working with Elisha, saying, "Thy servant, my husband, is dead. And thou knowest that the servants did fear the Lord. And the creditor is come to take unto him my two sons for bondsmen." In that day and age, if you didn't pay your bills, or if you left your bills and they probated the estate or whatever, Your kids were taken as slaves and they worked for you until the bills were paid off. Now, just to throw a little light into the subject, our national debt is $17.5 trillion. Every day the clock tick, 500 million, second, 500 million, third, 500 million. Right now, these kids on the front, my granddaughter back there, and she's barely 1 year of age, each one of you owe the federal government $300,000 in taxes to pay your share of the national debt. And at my age, I'm going to leave you a bunch, I'm afraid. They say in another 2 years, it'll be $18 trillion, could be as much as $20 trillion. Not enough money in the world. The debtors had to pay the debts of the parents. And the fact is, if I read the Bible, the parents are to lay up for the kids. The kids are not to lay up for the parents. So this woman was in trouble. Her sons had been or were about to be taken into bondsmen. In second verse, and Elisha said unto her, what shall I do for thee? Tell me, what hast thou in the house? And he said, thy handmaid hath not anything in the house save a pot of oil. Now I want you to remember something, that often when times of trouble or whatever are times of need, God will normally have something in your hands already that he can use or you can use to solve the problem that you think you're facing. And God is not unaware of the problem you're facing. Heaven is not short on money. They're not short on the Spirit of God. They're not short on angels. Jesus said, I could call 72,000 angels if I wanted to. Heaven is not suffering from an insufficiency. It's that we need the proficiency to believe that heaven exists, and heaven, in fact, then the God that lives there is our solution many, many times. It says, he said, thine handmaid hath not anything save a pot of oil, only a pot of oil. Then he said, go borrow the vessels abroad of all thy neighbors, even empty vessels, borrow not a few. He said, go out. Elijah already knew what he was going to do. He was going to fill these vessels with oil. And he was going to have her sell the oil, and they were going to pay off the debts, and she was going to go ahead and be happy. And when it happened, she did in fact go out, and they borrowed every kind of vessel that they could find, every shape and every size. And then the Bible says she went in and she closed the door behind her. It means she shut herself away from all of those that were bothering and so forth, and she shut herself in with the Lord. Now, if you're going to be a vessel for God, and you're going to live a life consecrated to the Lord, you're not going to be able to live like every Tom, Dick, and Harry. You're going to have to close the door behind you at times, and you're going to have to think more of serving God and what he thinks and what he wants you to do than all of those that are clamoring on you to go their way when they, in fact, don't have the answer, and you know they don't have the answer. You're going to have to learn to say no. You're going to have to commit yourself to the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not into your own understanding, and all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. I want you to go to Matthew chapter 6, verses 33 very quickly. Matthew chapter 6, 33. Now I want you to read this with me. Now before we read this, either I can put my faith in what this Bible says, either this is true, or this is the biggest lie that was ever perpetrated upon mankind. If it's a lie, then we are to burn the place, get out here and go live like hell, because that's all we've got. But if it's true, if this is true and means what it says it means, And we need some vessels of God filled with the Spirit that will believe in this God that I'm talking about. You're in a city of probably 2 million people. Is that too many or is that not enough? Is Seattle 2 million or is it more? I got lost the other night. My son came to the airport to get me and he took off like Johnny Vukovich. And I lost him and I went off. I was in part of a city. It reminded me of Brooklyn. They had paintings all over the wall. And I was wishing I had brought maybe an AK-47, but I finally got out of there. I didn't know where I was going, but I met him someplace. And we met up together and we came back. But it's 3 million people. You can get 100,000 people screaming their heads off and running wild, looking at a bunch of people run a pig football back and forth up and down the field and hollering, hoop, and carry on. And yet when it comes to church with eternity at stake, we can't get them in. But God can. God can. It says here, but seek ye first the kingdom of God. Do you hear me? You have a physical malady. You have a financial difficulty. You got a rebellious kid. You got a neighbor that's throwing garbage over in your yard that you'd like to poke. I have those same emotions. I told a guy one time at the office that was being ugly with my wife, and then he started bad-mouthing me for being a Christian. And I said to him, and I'm not going to tell you, but I weigh more than I should. I told the man, I said, you know, you should thank God you are a Christian. You see that plate glass door? That's probably what you would be going through about now. And I said, don't be bothered, my wife. And he calmed down very quickly. I was a little bit put out with him and angry, but it says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Now, to illustrate on what I'm talking about and make it personal, when we were living in Brooklyn, one time many years ago, 1977, I was home praying, asking God to send me someplace where they needed a preacher. And I was in the back of the bedroom, big old hot alligator tears streaming down my face, and a telephone rang. And I turned around, picked it up, and there was a guy from Brooklyn, New York. His name is Lord Larson. He was the head of the deacon board, and they called and they asked me to come to Brooklyn to candidate. Now, I'm 3,000 miles away. And I remember when Brent and I and our family, we loaded this truck and we headed for New York. He loved my dad, which is, I had the same relationship with my father. I remember for the first 200 miles, he and I both cried. We just cried and cried and cried because I left my dad standing at our business and I didn't know if I'd ever see him again. And we headed for New York City like the Beverly Hillbillies. We went there in 1977 and we began to go soul winning. I didn't have the whole church going soul winning, but we started going soul winning and talking to people, and people caught the vision and they started bringing people. And about 28 months later, I would preach to 400 adults every Sunday morning. I remember one morning we had 15 people saved, adults, tears. I've seen them on the front row weep and cry till I thought they were going to die. We baptized at every service. And I remember seeing Linda, her dad was one of the deacons. And when I candidated, I looked at her and she was playing the piano and I said, my son's looking for a wife. I said, we're going to add you to the list. And several years later, I married them. And they've been together now for about 30 years. 35 years. But it was, and if I ever made a mistake, I should have stayed in New York City. I still love it today. All the different cultures. We had people saved. It was amazing. but you to seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things should be added unto you. We didn't have any money. I had assisted, my third daughter had a hernia operation. We took down, and the doctor, we had the operation. We didn't know what insurance was. We were poor folks. And I just got out of Bible college. And he went and checked her over, and he said everything was fine. And they said, Pastor Ford, the nurse wants to see you. I said, oh, Lord. I hate, what am I going to tell him? I don't have the money. And the guy walked out, and he said, professional courtesy, you're a pastor. He said, the doctor told me to tell you, your bill is paid. And I went outside and I cried. I had another, we move on a little bit. My daughter, what she was going to, down to a college in Florida. And we couldn't pay her bill. And some of you are going to go through this. Daddy, I can't pay my bill. And I said, honey, I don't have the money. Well, I can't take my finals. And I tried to work something out with the people. Now, I don't encourage you to do this. And I'm getting to the sermon. I'm just laying some real, honest facts. So what I did in blind faith means you have no other option but to depend upon God. These people were being unkind to me, and they wouldn't let me work out anything. I went two stanchions over, and I got a new party. And I, in bold faith, wrote them a check for $3,000. That check for $3,000 was no good. And I headed for Texas. And I said, God, you said. And that check never bounced. That's blind faith. I heard of a young evangelist, his name was Tom Malone. He was preaching a meeting in Tennessee, and the church did not give him any money, and he had driven down there and he was out of gas. He pulled up to the station, and the station, he said, fill it up. He didn't know how he was going to pay for it. The man came back, one of these old pumpers. This is for you older people. The man came back and said to Tom Malone, he said, sir, there must be something wrong. He said, your tank's full. Your tank is full. I love to hear those stories. I love to see the reality of the Lord. Now, ladies, I want you to listen to me very closely. There were two Smith women. One was 84 and one was 82. One was had arthritic. She was so arthritic that she could barely bend over, and she couldn't walk. And the other one was blind, absolutely blind. These two women would get up every morning at 4 o'clock and pray and ask God. They would pray for the New Hebrides Islands. Now, this wasn't way back in the days. This was 1949. They began to weep and pray and cry and beg God for revival to come to the New Hebrides Islands. And all of a sudden, revival broke out in the New Hebrides Islands, and all of these natives with bones in their nose and voodoo and cannibalism started dropping to their knees. And all across these great islands, thousands and thousands in tears were weeping and crying and turning to a holy God. Only because two ladies sought God and began to pray. There was another great evangelist that won 1 million people to Christ. His name was D.L. Moody. Had a successful church in Chicago. These two women began to pray for D.L. Moody, and they said, he said, well, don't pray for me. I'm having people saved. Don't pray for me. And they kept praying for him and praying for him. And everywhere he would go, they would show up in the front row, and their heads would be bowed when he'd be preaching. And Moody could barely speak the king's English. He was a big, overset, heavy guy. They said they buried him in a piano box. Had a temper. And yet he was aggressive. And Moody was reading this Bible. And here's what Moody said. God is looking for vessels this morning, I'm telling you. Here's what D.L. Moody said. He said, the world has never seen what God can do with a man totally consecrated to Christ. He said, by God's holy grace, I'll be that man. And Moody never went to bed. He never went to bed. He never finished a day ever that he hadn't witnessed to one human being about the Lord Jesus Christ. Moody, they were praying for Moody, and Moody was walking up and down the streets of New York on Whitehall Street, where I used to go almost once or twice a week. When Moody was coming down Whitehall Street, the same Holy Spirit that lives inside of us came upon D.L. Moody in such a way that Moody had to go away and hide himself in a friend's apartment. And Moody made this statement. He was on his way to England to preach a revival meeting. He said, I used to preach a church service, and I would preach a message, and five would be saved. He said, I would take the Bible, and he said, I would preach the exact same message, and after God came upon me, I would have 100 saved. Because there's a lot of difference between man and God. Now, you young people, we get back. Let's go back to our story. For all of you that are here this morning, God is looking for a vessel. He's looking for a man. He's looking for several men. Go to Ezekiel chapter 22, verses 30. And what time is it, Brian? All right, I'm closing. I'm just going to be a few minutes, and I'm closing, and we're going to get out of here, and hopefully there'll be food left for us all. In Ezekiel 22:30, the Bible says, I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none. Now this woman filled all of these vessels. These vessels were filled. She sold the vessels. She sold the oil. And what happened? She paid the creditors and she had enough to live on. Now how God is looking for vessels, just like he's looking for vessels this morning, young people, old people, young people, that he can fill them with oil, the power of the Holy Spirit. If you're unsaved, he's looking to put his Spirit in you. And there's once again, you don't have to be some big shot. You don't have to be some oratorical preacher. You don't have to be some multimillionaire. You can be as common as yesterday's bird nest. You can be tall, short. You can be comfortably obese. You can be obese. You can be whatever. If your heart is clean, God is looking for somebody that he can use and pour out his Spirit and develop the purpose in your life. Young people, I'm 77 years of age, and I've got a lot of miles on me. I would beg you, don't allow somebody to ruin and trash your life. You have no idea what God can do and the wonder that God can be in your life. And if you've got people pulling you in the wrong direction or are asking you to do things that are wrong, kick them under the bus and follow God. All of us. This church has a purpose. This church, ask yourself, how long has it been since I witnessed to one human being about their soul? Ask yourself, when I walk down the streets and I drive down the streets, do I see these people lost and on their way to a Christless hell? I remember the time I used to drive up on the corners and sit there and cry like a baby looking at these kids that were going to end up and go to hell. And there's times after that I get to the point that I don't care if they go to hell. We become so apathetic. God is looking for vessels. And I asked you the simple question, and I close. How many of you this morning will say, God, I would like to be a vessel. I would like to be used at a much greater level than I'm being used. I'm not talking about arrogance. I'm not talking about foolishness. I'm talking about sincerity. And ladies, you ladies could revolutionize this church. You ladies can win more people than men can see. Kids, you can bring them, but you have to be a vessel that's clean and a vessel that wants to be filled with oil. Let's stand.